Share Board, we have two citizens who have signed in with public participation. And I will read the regulations for public participation. 30 minutes will be set aside for Board of Education meetings for public comment. This time limit may be increased at the board's discretion. Persons who wish to speak at a meeting must sign in prior to the meeting, stating name and topic of discussion. The following rules for addressing Board of Education shall apply. Two persons may speak on each side of an issue. Each speaker shall be limited to 5 minutes. Personnel issues should not be discussed in open meetings except as provided by federal, state, and local law and policy. References to an employee must be made using the terms teacher, administrator, or employee. Persons who refuse to follow accepted rules of conduct may be removed from the meeting. Persons speaking must address the Board of Education rather than an audience. And at this time, we have Mr. John Robinson. Contract language, is that it? Yes, contract language.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I'm John Robinson. I live at 3227 Sandy Lane Circle in Lake Park. And got a beautiful school, I must admit, to do that. Anyway. And the sad part about it is that, you know, a lot of us was excluded from doing some of the work out there. That's the sad part. It's a school that is predominantly black, a lot of black children. And it's sad that the contractors didn't get an opportunity where they need to have got one. So we feel that the language needs to be addressed as far as the oncoming projects that you may have that can guarantee that black contractors have a means of participating. I know that they made some laws that make it difficult to put something in place of that nature, but if you want to help the community and to revitalize the community, if we can get funds to flow back through the community, it would absolutely enhance it. If you change the environment, you change the people. And we got a lot of problems out there in the neighborhoods and the communities. And it's due to not having the funds and the monies to come through these low-income communities. I know the city got programs and the school board got programs, but we need some cooperation. And it needs to be put in a language so that it can work, not just a tone where people can be excluded and companies come in and get monies and leave out of the area and the funds to leave with them. It needs to be something that can be kept in place. You know, it's been kind of quiet here lately about this, but there's always a quiet just before a storm. And we are by no means giving up on this, but we do realize that the school is a lot of the work done been performed. It's been done in this past tense. And we do know that we definitely did not expect this to ever happen again in the history of this county. There can be steps can be taken. Not to say they're not going to be taken. Not going to stand here and say that we're not going to do anything, because we're not going to stand by and let this just go down the drain. People's lives have been altered from it, believe it or not. And we want to press upon your minds that we do need to have some form of a language that can reflect. It can be African-American, the children of the descendants of slaves, or however it needs to be put. But do we have some form of terminology that black contractors can almost be guaranteed that he gets participation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next we have Mr. George Boston Rhines. Thanks for listening. Action on the issue.
George Boston Rhines, 5204 Oak Drive, Valdosta, Georgia. I have quite a few items, but the first one, it made me feel good to see the students with a great accomplishment and getting awarded. It made me feel good, and I'm not even assisting in terms of where you all sit, so I can only imagine how good you all feel. Thank you for talking about springing and getting these meetings out to the public, because that's a good thing. On our form of government, the people, the taxpayers have a right to know. Too often I've worked from Port St. Joe all the way up to Atlanta, over near Augusta area. And I know how important it is for our children and parents to be notified. And in the state of Georgia, I don't know whether you all know it or not, there is a pattern in practice, as we call it, to suppress the information in Georgia, across Georgia. A white public journalist, Nydia Tisdale, you can Google her, and she was awarded $200,000 because they tried to ban her from a Republican Party meeting. And later, they called her back to court. She just got out of court I don't want to get too much into that, but I want you to know that you pay a price for doing what I do. There's a lot of things I can talk about, what they've done to me, but I will say that, or tried to do to me, but I will say that what I try to do is inform the people. That's all. I have over 1 million views around the world, 2,400 people on my site that are subscribers. That means every time I put up one video, it goes 2,400 people. And I want to say, when I talk about the streaming, I want to know that, I want you to know that 3 judges have come up against me. Toombs County up there, Toombs Judicial Circuit. They banned me from 7 counties, not for doing nothing wrong, but for doing something right. And I'm here on the 4-year criminal trespass, probably death of Kenneth Johnson, because I report what your news media will not report. A lot of cities that I go to, like the Board of Education, your local TV station and your radio station will be here, and they report it to the community. And I commend Valdosta for the great people we have working, but we also have a disconnect here, and I hope that that can be fixed. Last item, I want to commend this board, you particularly, Ms. Casey, for addressing and putting those flags up, my beautiful brother. I went to some of the locations, and the flag is up, and to me it looks real good. As a retired military veteran, I say it's a plus for all of us when we can see that flag and our children serving in the armed forces. And so, and not only that, there are some places that I have hit over 4 years ago and they have not complied with it. But I will assure you of one thing. I'm not off the case. I'm dead on the case. Like they say, dead eye Washington, I'm dead on it. Thank you.
But we always appreciate public participation and the public's interest in what's going on in the Valdosta City Schools. So come back anytime and see what's going on with your Board of Education. We love having you here. If I could get an approval of the agenda.
So moved. Second.
It's been moved and second. All those in favor? Unanimous. And now if I could get approval of the minutes from October the 24th.
Second.
It's been moved and second. All those in favor? Any abstentions? Thank you. Please review the minutes from November the 14th. And at this time, we have student and staff recognition.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Okay. I have a few things tonight. Let me get myself together here. The first thing on our agenda, and we're going to try to get to them pretty quickly because one of our students has a program at a school to get back to tonight. Each year, Dr. Kaysen has done an art contest to choose a winner to be the Valdosta City Schools Christmas card. And this year we had over 50 entrants, and Dr. Kaysen had a hard time picking, so this year we have 4 winners. We have a middle school, elementary school, high school, and VECA. So I would like to bring those artists up, and if their teacher or principal are here, we also have a card for you to take home, and then I also have your original artwork that you can take back with you. So if you guys, when I call your name, if you'll just come up front, we're going to take one big picture as well. Our first in the elementary school was Salas Mahone. He's a 4th grader, and he has a super cute little kitty cat that's wrapped up the Christmas lights and Santa were fantastic. Let me get you. We got lots of oohs and ahs for you. Make sure. There you go. This is for your school. Valdosta High School, we have Jocelyn.
Next item on our agenda is finance, and if we could get a report from Dr. Hudson, we'll just wait till swimming upstream, Dr. Hudson. Mm-hmm.
Good evening, Madam Chair Board.
Good evening.
October finances for Valdosta City Schools. We will start with the cash flow sheet. Cash flow sheet, let's talk about that one first. Cash flow, your expenditures for the month ended October 2017 payroll. We spent $2,541,090.30. With operating for the month of October, we spent $3,637,422.58 for a grand total of $6,178,512.88 for expenditures during the month of October. Revenue for the month of October, QBE, you see what we collected there, $3,130,692. And for taxes, the month ending October, we collected $3,940,292.41 for a grand total of $7,070,984.41 for revenue collected during the month of October. Cash on hand, you see what we have at GIP on the first date for a total of $12,191,988.31. SPLOS cash flow, SPLOS 4, we just ended SPLOS 4, so the last collection we received was for $756,325, there you see that, that was a pretty good month there, to end SPLOS 4, so with SPLOS 4 we currently have $8,887,259.52. Debt service, 2012, you see what we have there, debt service for 2012, this is for Pineville. We have $5,259,732.24. That will remain there. We have one more bond payment in February of 18 for $5,247,900. And if you go out, you see that for February. That's our last bond payment for Pineville, and we will have expired those bonds. Construction for Valdosta High School, we have $7,073,871.51 remaining in that account, and we are on track there at the high school, so things are looking great there. And then the debt service for the high school, we have $1,701,416.70, and that will sit there because we have an interest payment that's coming up in January 2018. You'll see, if you go out, you'll see that interest payment, what's due there in January. The first bond payment for Valdosta, the new Valdosta High School, will not be until February 2019. Okay. So the next time you get this cash flow report, you see a line item there for SPLOS 5. And so we'll start showing you what we're collecting for SPLOS 5.
What's that first payment?
For?
The bond?
The bond?
High school.
High school?
The amount?
The amount. I have to get that 8.3.
Yes, sir.
Okay. See that interest payment that we have coming up. Okay. Any questions about cash flow? Okay. All right. Next, we have general fund budget status report. We'll start with the general fund revenue. Under your local taxes there year-to-date, we have collected $4,233,570.64, and that is 16.61% of our projected budget that we've collected thus far, so we're on track there. interest earned, you see what we collected year-to-date, $37,626.05. And then other local revenue, we have collected $25,726.74. So we're on track there budget-wise, percentage-wise with collections. QBE, you see the different categories, what we collected year-to-date, in all those categories, we've collected $7,883,495.19. Okay. And then if you drop down, total general revenues, year-to-date, we have collected $12,047,151.62. And that is 18.25% of our budget. And again, we are in line, and so we're moving in the right direction there. Under expenditures, year-to-date expenditures, we have spent $14,690,456.38. Okay? And that is 22.26% of our budget, and so we are in line there. So there's nothing out of the ordinary with our revenues and our expenditures. Everything's in line. Questions? Okay. Madam Chair, next on the agenda, we have the FY19 budget calendar, and that is for action. We need to approve the FY19 budget calendar as we prepare to get ready for our planning sessions for our FY19 budget. Any questions about the calendar? Okay. Opportunity to review it.
Madam Chair, Board, as you all know, we have been discussing the reinstatement of the Ghana trip for several weeks, and I think we're at a point where we need to make a vote to decide if we're going to allow our students to attend or to travel to Ghana for an exchange program. One last Friday, Ms. Bell and I met with a young lady from Ghana, and she is the sponsor or will be facilitating or helping facilitate Ghana's portion of that trip or opportunity for them to come to us. And so I made a recommendation that possibly, and this is something the board needs to think about and discuss as well, that as opposed to us or our kids traveling first to Ghana, maybe Ghana students can travel to us first so that the board would have an opportunity to speak with those children, talk to some of the teachers and those parents who will be coming with their children. And so I heard at about 5:30 this afternoon that those officials in Ghana have approved the trip for their kids to come to us first if the board votes to allow them to come. Now what we also expressed to those here, our teachers here, is that it's all contingent upon the vote tonight, whether or not we're even going to partner with the exchange. If we decide, if you all vote not to, then that will again alleviate or void the opportunity for those from Ghana to come to us as well. So I think tonight we need to have discussion, if at all possible, and then decide if that's the direction of the board to vote tonight. If not, we could table it as well. So we have some options here tonight.
Okay. All right, so can we open the floor for discussion?
Need to get a motion on the floor.
Yeah, first, okay. So can I get a motion?
Madam Chair, I motion we have a discussion on the golf trip.
Second. Okay, so we need a second.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I want to be clear tonight on my concern for the students as well as the teachers and the chaperones that could possibly be traveling on this trip. I've gotten a few letters in regards to, letter in regards to the British trip. Let me let you know where I stand as a board member. First of all, I don't think any parent's going to send their kid in a hot situation where a fight is going on and they're going to be in danger. So, and I don't want to compare apples with oranges. There have been some problems. We all know that with the gun trip. However, I want our kids' minds to be expanded in any way possible as far as obtaining knowledge from around the globe. I am ready to support the trip, Dr. Case, and Board of Education. As long as we can monitor the situation and no hot spots are going on in that area. That's my two cents.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments? Yes, Ms. Blake.
I'm in support of the trip. And I understand the issues that Mr. Lee is voicing, but in our current state of our world in day and time, any place that we would have thought was safe could be a hot spot at any time. So I don't want to put it out there that we're just looking at Ghana as being a hot spot, because I believe the last time we sent our children to England, I think either it was a week before or the week after they came back, there was a bombing in the underground subway. So it's not like we're just looking at Ghana and saying if Ghana is a hot spot, because in the state of our world now, any place can be a hot spot. So I think that any parent that is really seriously looking into sending their children to Ghana, which I would be one of those parents if I had the opportunity, and I would hope that those parents would do the same due diligence that I would do in sending my children anywhere in the world. I don't even care if it's in the United States. You just have to be that vigilant, regardless of where you send your children. So I just think that it's an opportunity that we should look into for our students, and that I would feel a little more easier in voting for it by having them come to us first and seeing exactly how their organization is run, the students, the faculty, and everything coming here. And then it even gives our parents an even longer opportunity to fundraise and everything, and get everything together to make sure that when we do make the decision to send our students there, that we'll be doing it with all of our preparation that we can possibly do, because some of these things are truly out of our control.
Yes.
Madam Chair, I agree with Mr. Lee and Mrs. Flukas on that. I certainly think it's something we want the children to be able to do, but let's get it back engaged. But at this point in time, I am in support of it if they come to us first, because of the problems that we've had in the past with some of their sponsors, and we had some serious issues that, quite frankly, we could have been held extremely liable and put in a very bad position. So we just need to get comfortable with it. Gives us time to meet them, for us to flesh through all of them, and gives our people the time to get organized the way it should be organized, and so that matters are taken care of in a professional manner.
So if we, in the vote tonight, if we approve the trip with them coming first, is there another opportunity to come together to decide if we're going to send our kids, or yes, would that be?
It would be after those students come to us in the fall, right, or whenever they can come. Once you all have an opportunity to have conversations with that group that's coming, then the board then can return vote again to allow our students to travel over.
Okay, so we're basically voting tonight to allow
all them to come.
The children from Ghana to come to, yeah,
Madam Chair, I'm very much in support of this. I think it's fabulous for our kids. I think it will be creating a worldview that is out of South Georgia, which I think is healthy for all of us. So I'm in support of the trip.
I also think that they come to get hurt. There's no time. So I'm agreeing with that.
One support. Okay. Very good. All right. Well, then, it's a call for the question, correct?
Well, wait a minute.
Your motion needs to be restated.
I would rescind that motion, and then we'll put another motion on the floor.
So did you make the original motion? No.
Mr. Bush.
Okay, so you rescind?
Yes, I rescind.
Okay.
A motion for discussion.
All right, so now can I get a motion?
Madam Chair, I'd like to make a motion that we approve that the Ghana students come to visit us at such a time as their schedule permits, and that we set that up and we approve that.
Okay, it's been moved and second. All those in favor?
Who was the second?
Dr. Moses.
Thank you.
All those in favor? It's unanimous. All right, moving on to superintendent's report.
Madam Chair, Board, would perhaps draw your attention to school visits and meetings. If you have any questions at this time, I'll be glad to answer any questions that you may have regarding school business annual meetings. Or the week, the time from November 14th to December 11th.
Any questions for Dr. Benson?
If there are no questions, Madam Chair, if I may, at your spot, you have a handout that highlights our 10th year anniversary of BECA, and we have 10 things to know about BECA. And so if you have conversations in Walmart or you have places, this will give you some highlights about our early college academy and the 10 years that it's been in existence. So we're very proud, as you all are, of BECA and the students there. Thankfully, I have a son who is a student, and as a parent, I'm very, very pleased with his experiences at this time.
Thank you.
Uh-huh.
That's great. Thank you so much.
Thank you to Ms. Brown for putting that together for us.
Is that it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, moving on to miscellaneous. I asked that Dr. Kaysen put this item on the agenda for us to review our experience at GSBA, because I feel like we always come back and have great discussions while we're there, and we talk about it, and we come home, and we don't ever get to talk about, again, the really valuable things that we learn. So I know we split up and attended different sessions. So the particular session that I was signed up for was community leaders, school boards as community leaders and advocates for schools. And so several of us attended that particular session. And really the actual title is Redefining the Role of School Boards as Community Leaders and Advocates for Schools. And it's something that I think all of us have talked about and felt, that, and it's something that's been on my heart, is how can we as a school system invigorate our community to value education for their children and to value education for our city? What can we do to instill trust? What can we do to make people excited about the school system? What can we do to lead the charge? Because if we don't lead it, it's not going to happen. And so we attended this session, and I will say for those of us that were in that session, at first we were a little bit frustrated because we felt like it was a lot of bells and whistles and no substance. But when we got into talking with other board members from other systems, that's when you get these little nuggets of what people are doing in their systems that they're excited about. So I wanted to share those, and I hope that Dr. Kasin didn't get to participate in a whole session, and he didn't get to hear some of these things. So there are items that I think our administration perhaps can listen to and perhaps flesh out for us. One thing that Ms. Bell and Ms. Lucas did, and Mr. Lee, I think, also participated, was sort of a kickoff to the school year. And one system called it September Saturdays. And they had every Saturday in September, and we can do this in August, and what y'all did was sort of a kickoff for our students, and even thinking about perhaps hosting this in the stadium, where we have book bags prepared for children, and they can come and get a kickoff. This would be something that probably, Scarlett, that might fall under your wheelhouse. But where they can come and collect a school bag with all of their items for whatever grade they're going to enter, and different community partners can help us put those bags together. School board members can be there passing them out along with whoever else we would like to participate. But that's just a way to let the community and the students know that their school board is excited about the school year, and then we want our students to have what they need. So we're ahead of the game because we've done it on a small scale, and now we can magnify that into a bigger scale. And having something like a kickoff to the school year, and certainly we have a great venue to do that that people get excited about with our football stadium. One school system, and I think we've talked about this idea as well, having a school bus, a technology school bus, that travels around, even on the weekends, into our various neighborhoods that are full of computers so that our parents can learn how to access a website. Look at Parent Portal. Have our students actually have an opportunity to get on there and perhaps work on a project on a Saturday when they wouldn't have access to that because they don't have Wi-Fi and they can't get to the library or whatever. So that was something in another system had incorporated that was sponsored by the school system to travel around into the community to help support our students on the weekend with technology. Twice a year, one school system, and this also might fall under your, I'm so glad you're here, Scarlett. twice a year, their school board sat down with the city council, with the county commissioners, with the industrial authority, and they met as a whole, and they talked about things that affected them, things that were going on, things that they were that were on their agendas that they were trying to get across. I think including juvenile justice would be fantastic. If we need to have conversations. We don't need to operate as islands unto ourselves. Mr. Johnson over at the Lowndes School Board also thought it might be a good opportunity for the Lowndes Board to sit with us in that meeting, and or maybe just the two school systems get together and meet twice a year and address our various needs. There are lots of things that we don't need to duplicate that we could help each other out on. One of these, this little Becca thing, one school system had talking points that they had put together, perhaps their PR person or somebody put it together, and they all had it on their phone. So when they were at the Walmart, they could say, "Well, look, let me tell you the real statistics, or let me tell you the real facts, or no, this is blah blah blah." So they had it right at their fingertips. Because for some reason, when somebody asked me a question, I'm like, "I don't know." You just get on the spot there. Community tours, which we've done with the Board of Realtors, but they've offered it. Some systems have offered it up to the entire community, which I think is great. TV streaming of the school board meetings. It costs a little bit to get it set up, but they actually have their students run the live streaming of and they said it has been very well received because people can tune in and watch the school board meetings for themselves, and no offense, but if the paper gets it wrong, then maybe that's, it's okay yourself, or the paper gets it right, and they can say, yeah, the paper was exactly right about that. So it would be nice. It would be nice to have it streamed. But again, there's a little bit of expense with that. And my favorite, which costs no money, and is the best idea I heard in the meeting, was each of us commit to attending 5 events during the year. And at each meeting, we can be reminded, you know, there's the band Christmas concert. One of us needs to go to that. There's, and some of us do attend a lot of things because we have children in the system, but there's the soccer banquet. Somebody needs to go to that. There's tennis finals. One of us could, there's 9 of us. We can certainly attend 5 things, and we can, and I think if we remind ourselves of them and we know about them, we'd love to go. There are plenty. You know, Mr. Roundtree is so good about sending us what's going on in the pack, and half the time, you know, it's the next night, and I can't go. But if we had some heads up, we could make a calendar that we can keep up with who's going where and when. Okay, so those are little individual tidbits that came out of that, and those of you that were in there, Vanessa and Trey and Deborah, is that just the 4 of us? Were you there too?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Anything that you got from that particular session that I haven't touched on? Go ahead. Vanessa.
The bus, there was 2 variations of the bus. One variation was we had technology in the bus and we had it geared toward the parents. So the things that we expect our parents to be able to access or like sending home links. Some parents don't even know what links are and how to access them. That's what's one bus was set up for, but then another district set up a bus to capture those kids that are about to come into our kindergarten or pre-K system, and they said that they would just go into the neighborhoods, and once they started getting the kids on board and they started reading the books and touching the technology, and it was hard to get them off, and they said they would just come and park it. It was almost like a war cry because they said, oh, the bus is going to be in such and such neighborhood, like the ice cream man, such and such neighborhood today. And they said it would always be packed. So that's another way that we may be able to access that population that we're still trying to grab a hold of so that we can have them in our system to move us forward. And it was just a matter of having a retired teacher. She was a retired first grade or kindergarten teacher, something like that. And she volunteered to man the bus. They had a bus driver, and she was just like, just the faces of the students. But she said the parents was the biggest draw. She said because you saw some parents, rain, shine, whatever, they were lining up to get their kids on that bus so that they can get read to, and they could touch the technology, and they could start being, you know, their brains could start being activated to get ready for school. So that was another, and they just gutted out a bus, and they just put the things that we would normally put in a book nook or something like that, all of that was placed on the bus, and they just moved from neighborhood to neighborhood. And one more thing, Deborah and I stayed for the keynote speaker on Saturday, and it was Dr. Couch from Apple. And the information that he gave us, the one book that I'm going to try and read over the Christmas break is Rewiring Education. It was just the things that he presented to us about how we're going to have to throw the whole education model pretty much out and start moving to what our kids know. He gave the example for our grandparents where they didn't have running water and electricity in their homes. And when they did get older and they started to see homes with electricity and water, they were like, wow, technology is so this. But with our kids, they were born with the internet. They've always had these devices. Babies growing up and having these in their hands as soon as they come out of the womb. This is their world. This is what they know. And for us to keep constantly telling them to shut off the device or not to use this, they don't know what encyclopedias are because they have Google. Why do they need an encyclopedia when they have Google? You know, and it was just funny. And they had a quote on the board that said, education is what people do to you. Learning is what you do for yourself. So it was just the whole, you know, idea of education now changing, and that we really, if we really want to be able to really hone in and capitalize on the greatness and the creativity of our children, we really have to think about throwing out the model and going in a different rate to make sure that our kids are learning and that we're able to compete and be able to do what we need to do in the future. Dr. Kaysen and I have been talking about this idea, funny, even before this meeting, but that, you know, we get frustrated and we get saddened by the fact that, you know, so many of our children come from situations that, you know, are not conducive for them to learn. And we feel helpless. But I think that there are many, many things we can do to lead the community. And I think it's got to be us. It's not going to be somebody else. And we've got to be our advocates for our school system and for our children. And I'll be honest with you. When I went to the conference this year, I got just kind of overwhelmed and driving up there thinking, oh my gosh, there's no conference. But I was so reinvigorated by the idea that, you know, there are great things that we could be doing. And it's almost like I feel like a revival is coming, and that we really can lead the charge. So I'm thankful for all of y'all that were there and could hear all those things. And I'm excited about what we can do to get the community involved and change the perception of why you need an education. Yes, so in conjunction with that, we're going to tell you a reminder, but we'll go ahead and tell you now. There's going to be a community forum on Tuesday, January the 16th at VMS with just this idea in mind. Dr. Kaysen and as many of us that can come will be in attendance and staff, and just have a chance for parents to ask questions, stakeholders to ask questions. Walk in there and say, you know, why do you do this way? I'll give you a silly little example. Several years ago, someone said, why does the school board make us be in that football classification? I said, well, we don't get a choice in that. That GHSA decided that. Really? I mean, misconceptions like that, you know, that people have, and gosh, that was about sports. So think of the misconceptions people may have about other things that we don't have any control over, which is another frustration, but that's okay. So please try to attend. I think this will be a good way to kick off an outreach to the community that we want to partner and we want to meet their needs and be as transparent as possible and provide the best education that we can for the students in the school system. January the 16th at VMS, 6 p.m. This is your reminder, so we just kind of jumped. All right, now, did anybody attend? Mr. Lee, you attended a different session.
Yeah, I attended
legal.
Lucas section and legal.
Legally.
And it was very, very, very rewarding. School of Hard Times, always is interesting.
Mm-hmm.
But yes, it was a lot of new things that come in the sexual harassment.
Hot topic.
And they asked all boards of education to look at their policy. Make sure that it's in line with the things in it that needs to be there.
Okay.
I'm sure the session that I attended actually is something we've talked about before, cameras and classrooms.
Mm-hmm.
So there were three districts there, three superintendents that talked about the positives and the benefits of having cameras in the classroom, one being curbing discipline, two being providing an opportunity for teachers to capture their lessons, and for those students who might be either homebound or absent, then they could go and download those lessons and give kids opportunities to review those lessons when they're absent. And so the three school districts were, while it's very expensive, one camera system costs about $3,500. But they
they use Title I funds, they use SPOS funds and other funds to equip many of their classrooms. Gwinnett County, Newton County, and one other county school district has implemented in their classroom. So it could be something that we explore in the future. But cameras plus sound system, so to amplify the voice of the teacher, as well as capture, you know, what's going on in the classroom. Mm-hmm. So
I attended that last year, mm-hmm. Madam Chair. I would love to see us put that program in beta, you know, somewhere to try it and test it, mm-hmm. because it's proven scientifically that kids learn so much better when the voice of the teacher is amplified in that room. So.
I wanted to attend, but I knew we were talking about it before, mm-hmm. and hear those three superintendents.
Okay. We could visit a school that brought in a few of us to do that if y'all, mm-hmm. if we actually had genuine interest as a board, you know.
And they welcome that.
Could they give us some statistics on discipline? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I think they have PowerPoints and to put it down in GSBA.
Okay.
Okay, sure. But I thought it was very interesting.
Okay. Any other comments?
I'd like to comment. I attended the one with you all on that, and then I attended one that this, and for our guests that don't know, that Mrs. Flukas was actually a presenter at this year's conference with her book,
The Great Promise Partnership.
And actually, Valdosta was recognized. We were the first, not the first, but we were the first on one of the awards you shared.
We're a cornerstone community. And the city of Valdosta was one of the first municipalities back in 2012 to jump on board with this initiative with Mike Beatty, who at the time was the executive director for the Department of Community Affairs. And now he's completely 100% Great Promise Partnership. And it's where we're targeting our at-risk youth at Valdosta High, where we're giving them an opportunity to work together, gain an income, and to also get those job skills and those soft skills that are needed for them to either go off and find an employment elsewhere or to start college and things of that nature. And the biggest plus for the program is that we keep them in school to where they graduate. So
it's a great program, and they've been, thanks to Vanessa and the city of Valdosta, we've been a leader on that side of it. And I believe y'all hired 10. Basically keep 10 working a year, I think.
We initially started with 10, and now we have 20 staff at the city.
So there's 20. There's children working with the city in all the different departments, permit department, recycling department. They're all over the place learning all kinds of different skills and job skills at an early age. And on that note, then, we all attended in the panel that afternoon, on Friday afternoon, on the CTAE. We had Mike Rule, who is the chairman of the state school board. Then we had the gentleman's name, who is the president and head of all technical college in the state of Georgia, and then their association, ED, I think. They really spent a lot of time on that. And Mike, the chairman, happens to be a friend of mine. He's from up in Gwinnett. And we bent his ear a little bit. We let him know there's a lot of things happening there. There's Representative Carter will be accepting and taking on a position with that. So we'll have one of our own, so to speak, up there as well. But I've asked Mike in the future that as these things come down, because they're really looking at all of that and with the, you know, not everybody is going to go to college, but they need some type of post-secondary education that could help them and or develop those skills while we have them in high school, so that when they leave us, if they're not going to do any of that, at least they have a skill that they can take and get a good paying job. Because there's, I've been under construction project at my house for the last 90 days, and Mrs. Wilson's families in business.
Expansion, of course, is a lot, right?
Yeah, right. But if you're working subcontractors, you know, number one, is there's an extreme shortage. It's hard to find people to come work. And these people are in such high demand. And let me tell you, in my paying job, some of my best and most successful clients are tradespeople, and a lot of them didn't attend college. So nothing against college. It's a great thing, but it's not for all people. But there are good jobs and good wages out there. You know, call an electrician, call a plumber, call HVAC people over to your house, and when you get that bill, you'll know that it's a good living. So we've reached out to them and asked that if they have any special projects or they have anything, and I'm actually going to try and get them down here to the new school so that they can look at what we've got and give us more ideas, and you know, if they've got something new they want to try, to confirm myself, to volunteer us to be the South Georgia guinea pig, or whatever they may want to look into. So it's, anyway, I thought that was very interesting.
Yeah. Wonderful. Thank you. Any other comments about the conference? Thank you for sharing your ideas and for listening to mine too. I appreciate that. At this time, we can move on to public participation.
Madam Chair, Board, we have two citizens who have signed in with public participation, and I will read the regulations for public participation. 30 minutes will be set aside for Board of Education meetings for public comment. This time limit may be increased at the Board's discretion. Persons who wish to speak at a meeting must sign in prior to the meeting, stating name and topic of discussion. The following rules for addressing the Board of Education shall apply. Two persons may speak on each side of an issue. Each speaker shall be limited to 5 minutes. Personnel issues shall not be discussed in open meetings except as provided by federal, state, and local law and policy. References to an employee must be made using the terms teacher, administrator, or employee. Persons who refuse to follow accepted rules of conduct may be removed from the meeting. Persons speaking must address the Board of Education rather than an audience. And at this time, we have Mr. John Robinson. Contract language, is that it?
Yes,
contract language.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I'm John Robinson. I live at 3227 San Diego Circle in Lake Park. And got a beautiful school. I must admit, to do that. And the sad part about it is that, you know, a lot of us was excluded from doing some of the work out there. That's the sad part. It's a school that is predominantly black, and black, you know, a lot of black children. And it's sad that the contractors didn't get an opportunity where they need to have gotten one. So we feel that the language needs to be addressed as far as the oncoming projects that you may have that can guarantee that black contractors have a means of participating. I know that they made some laws that make it difficult to put something in place of that nature, but if you want to help the community and to revitalize the community, if we can get funds to flow back through the community, it would absolutely enhance it. If you change the environment, you change the people. And we got a lot of problems out there in the neighborhoods and the communities. And it's due to not having the funds and the monies to come through these low-income communities. I know the city got programs and the school board got programs, but we need some cooperation. And it needs to be put in a language so that it can work, not just a tone where people can be excluded and companies come in and get monies and leave out of the area and the funds to leave with them. It needs to be something that can be kept in place. You know, it's been kind of quiet here lately about this, but there's always a quiet just before a storm. And we are by no means giving up on this, but we do realize that the school is a lot of work done been performed. It's been done in this past tense. And we do know that we definitely are not expecting this to ever happen again in the history of this county. There can be steps can be taken. Not going to say they're not going to be taken. Not going to stand here and say we're not going to do anything, because we're not going to stand by and let this just go down the drain. People's lives have been altered from it. believe it or not. And we want to press upon your minds that we do need to have some form of a language that can reflect. It can be African American, or the children of the descendants of slaves, or however it needs to be put. But do need to have some form of terminology that black contractors can almost be guaranteed that he gets participation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next we have Mr. George Boston Rhines. Thanks for listening. Action on the issue.
George Boston Rhines, 5204 Oak Drive, Valdosta, Georgia. I have quite a few items, but the first one, it made me feel good to see the students with great accomplishment and getting awarded. It made me feel good, and I'm not even assistant to where you all sit, so I don't matter how good you all feel. Thank you for talking about streaming and getting these meetings out to the public, because that's a good thing. On our form of government, the people, the taxpayers have a right to know. Too often I've worked from Port St. Joe all the way up to Atlanta, over near Augusta area. And I know how important it is for our children and parents to be notified. And in the state of Georgia, I don't know whether you all know it or not, there is a pattern and practice, as we call it, to suppress the information in Georgia, across Georgia. A white public journalist, Nydia Tisdale, you can Google her, and she was awarded $200,000 because they tried to ban her from a Republican Party meeting. And later, they called her back to court. She just got out of court. I don't want to get too much into that, but I want you to know that you pay a price for doing what I do.
I have never seen anybody misrepresent their stands as much as Michelle Nunn did. She all she wanted to do is talk about, we need to have a team, we need to have consensus building, we need this and that. And I thought I was going to have to resuscitate my wife. I thought she was going to pass out, and I thought I was going to absolutely puke listening to her. I mean, I don't know why you're videotaping, but yes, I said that.
There's not been any private sector job loss. The job loss comes from 45,000 jobs lost.
What is your name? What is your name? What is your name? Sir, what is your name? What is your name, sir? Identify yourself. What is your name? What is your name? Let go of me. What is your name, sir? Let go of me. I spoke with the owner prior to this event beginning. No, Mrs. Burtz, Kathy Burtz, said it was okay.
You need to identify yourself.
Been real nice. Now you're going to jail for resisting arrest. Do not stop.
Please stop, ma'am. We're asking you
to help get people here. I am sorry that people are treating you this way. This is wrong. I am sorry that people are treating you this way. This is wrong.
Thank you.
This is wrong. I am sorry that people are treating you this way. This is wrong. I am sorry that people are treating you this way. This is wrong. I am sorry that people are treating you this way. This is wrong. I am sorry that people are treating you this way. This is wrong. I am sorry that people are treating you this way. This is wrong. I am sorry that people are treating you this way. This is wrong. Sorry that people are treating you this way. This is wrong. Sorry that people are treating you this way. This is wrong. I am sorry that people are treating you this way. This is wrong. am sorry that people are treating you this way. This is wrong. I am sorry that people are treating you this way. This is wrong. I am sorry that people are treating you this way. This is wrong. Sorry that people are treating you this way. This is wrong.
This is the...
To meet Libby Pearson, City Commission.
Thank you, Mr. Worthy. Again, thank you, Mr. Worthy. To begin, I'm going to fall back on something that Mr. Presley mentioned. He said that you stated that it had nothing to do with the group. Well, I'm not sure that you stated it didn't have anything to do with the group. I know just a minute ago, Jerry Hudson said it was mainly on Douglas Now, it was mainly about Bobby Worthy.
His article was?
Not quite. Supported by
Libby
Commissioner
Pearson.
That's what he stated,
yep.
Which was a total lie because I had nothing to do with Bobby Worthy and Larry Neesmith. That was totally separable from this whole thing that you all have blown to hell. That's what you've done.
Your name wasn't on that flyer for it, for the meeting, as a supporter?
Who held the meeting?
sure my name would be on it.
Okay,
well, see, that's where you went wrong.
That's all we said.
No, that's not all you said. That's not all you said. You said supported by Commissioner Pearson. What was supported by Commissioner Pearson?
The meeting
that I called, that's exactly right. I called the meeting. Justice League did not call the meeting, first and foremost. They didn't call the meeting. I held a meeting through Southern Rural Black Women's Initiative for Economic and Social Justice. I invited Mr. Bobby Worthy and the NAACP. Let me finish, Mr. Hudson.
That was the point of the article. The mention of you.
No. You claim that the Justice League held this meeting, which was a lie. It was a lie. You said it, as well as the Douglas Enterprise said it. Justice League did not hold a meeting here in Douglas, Georgia. Southern Rural Black Women's Initiative held a meeting. I invited Mr. Worthy. I invited Ms. O'Hara as district rep for the NAACP. I invited Mr. Hal Presley. And matter of fact, I invited the entire community of the city of Douglas, Coffee County, Georgia. I announced it on my city council meeting. So why in the world, tell me, would I hold a meeting that's gonna succumb to or support hatred towards white people or any other people? Why would I hold a public announcement of a meeting like that? I haven't been in office for 15 years to do something so low down and dirty. See, you had your facts, you had your statements incorrect. Had you all given us the respect and decency to come and ask a question, you were at the meeting when I announced about that flyer. If you had a concern or issue about it being to hate white folks or kill white folks, seemed like to me you would have had the courtesy, being that you were there, to have came to me, Commissioner Pearson, what is this about? But no, not one of you, journalism fellas or lady, I'm not sure what part you played in it, so if you did play a part, excuse that comment. Not one of you had the decency or respect to come to me as an elected official and ask the question, what is this all about? A decent journalist who is seeking the truth has a moral and ethical obligation to go and get both sides of a story and not just print one side and not just assume. And none of you did that. So yes, I feel my life is threatened with something like this. And you sat there when Mr. Presley asked the question, have you gotten any feedback from anybody? Nobody would say anything. You didn't answer it. But I already know the answer to it. You've gotten feedback. Because I've gotten feedback. I've gotten feedback from white people. I've got feedback from black people. And they're not satisfied with it, black or white. And they have all said to me, Olivia, we know that's not true. So some people who might not know me might not know. But those who know me know I wouldn't take part in anything that's going to deal with hatred or killing or anything in breaking the law. So on now today, you all want to come and be a part of this press release, this news conference on today, after you have done your damage. Because like I say, damage has been done. Because don't everybody know all of us and what we stand for. It's just the grace of God that those who do know us know we wouldn't dare partake of any such foolishness.
Amen.
And I feel like what you're doing is displaying what you have in your heart.
Amen.
To print something like this.
Amen.
Yes. I can say to you, not one of you have ever had me to say anything racist to you, to say anything about hatred to you, in dealing with your media and dealing with me. None of you can say that I've ever said anything racist.
Right.
If it's right, if it's a fact about what has happened, and it might tend to lean on one side of the color line or the other, call it what you may. But God be my judge. He knows my heart. And no, I wouldn't partake of anything such as this that you all have intended to influence this community to
it. So now you want to go and dig and talk about the use of the Coley Center. Get the records about the Coley Center. You dig on and see what you find. If anybody got any money for using the Coley Center, it definitely was not Commissioner Olivia Coley Pearson.
Right?
All right. I have never used the Coley Center or any facility of the City of Douglas in an inappropriate manner. That's why I announced the meeting of that we were having on October 3rd. That's why I announced it at my City Council meeting. And I said then, anybody who is concerned about the community and would like to help and take part, please come. That was my request. But you all are tending to try to divide this community more and more and more. I'm concerned as to who employs the Douglas Knight employees, as well as the Douglas Enterprise. What do these people stand for? I'm really surprised at this time. I'm surprised because your editor should have told you, go get the other side, see what they have to say about it before we print this.
Should have been fast checked.
It should have been.
Should have been fast checked.
And it's sad. It's sad because it's too late in the day with too much everything that's going on in our surroundings and our communities and our different states. It's too much and too late in the day to try to print something like this to make white folk feel that they need to go and buy guns, which was announced at a church, church meeting. Announced at church by a white lady that she needs to go and buy a gun because of this group that has been formed. And I suggest to the rest of y'all that y'all go by one is what she was quoted as saying. So if it's in y'all's heart to cause this kind of deliberate tension and division, you need to go check yourselves.
They damage the community.
You need to go check yourselves. God is not pleased. God is not pleased. When I chose to run for office, I found all kind of opposition. Some by black folks, but some by white folks. And ever since I've been in office, I had to deal with you all saying statements that were not true, trying to blemish my name. So whatever it is you're seeking, I hope you find it. But I can tell you, my name is not going to be blemished because the people know what I stand for. When I talk to the white city employees, Commissioner Pearson, we know you're not like that. But like I say, my concern is the people who do not know me. Who do not know me.
Amen.
Because my mother, an honorable woman, who I got emails and texts from people telling me when I expressed what was going on my Facebook page, they said, we know what your mother stood for. We know she didn't raise you that way. But I'm wondering, how have you all been raised? Yes, I'm wondering today. I'm wondering today. Because somebody from the media should have had the decency to see the true facts. So justice would be known and would prevail.
That's right.
This plaque, since you all say recent altercation shines light on new militant organization, that's what y'all said. That's what y'all said. I'm trying to find out where is this militant organization at. Because it's not us. It's not us. Some of us can barely walk. We are elderly. Walking with sticks. But we are militant. Because we state what is the truth. We're seeking to make the community better, which is what I said at that city council meeting when I announced that meeting on October 3rd. So how did militant organization come out of it? It's wrong. The meeting I had, Southern Rural Black Women, has been here in Douglas Coffee County since 1999. And I was asked to chair and lead this group. Southern Rural Black Women's Initiative for Economic and Social Justice. Not just justice for black people. Of black women, but it's geared toward women because women have had a difficult time finding daycare, someone to keep their kids so they can go to work, trying to finish and get a GED so they can get a good job. That's why this group was formed and has received federal monies and monies from private groups to help people who are a part of this to better their lives. And you would take the meeting we held, which was held, hosted by Southern Rural Black Women, and distort the facts. Shame on you. Shame on you.
This is the Get to Free Press, and we report what others ignore.
This is your First Amendment right to know without whiteouts from a controlled news media whiteout network. And we are located in Valdosta, Georgia, and we are here to inform, educate, and persuade if necessary. Always keep that in mind. Moreover, I want to say to you that as a community, state, nation, and world, we are not who we claim to be, but who we prove ourselves to be over a given period of time. And if we are a liar, time will tell. And if we are a racist or a hater, time will tell. And our righteous and holy God already know. So you are only fooling yourselves. Again, the Ghetto Free Press. I'm George Boston Rice.